When I was growing up in the 70s, I loved the robots in Star Wars, but I was also kind of scared of robots in movies, where the evil robots, where they're going to take over the world. And today, a lot of people are talking about robot drivers or robot drones. So it's either like they're really good or really bad. And what's the real future of robots, and why do we have such a love-hate relationship with them?
I'm Tiffany Shlain. I'm a mother, filmmaker. I founded the Webby Awards. And this series is about how the future doesn't start somewhere far off in the distance. The future starts here.
Because I'm so fascinated with robots, it's a really good thing that I married a professor of robotics.
Am I looking at you, or?
So do you think robots are going to surpass humans and take over?
No, we don't need to worry about robots surpassing us.
That's why I love him. He doesn't believe robots are going to take over.
Actually, the more I learn about robots, the more I realize how far we still have to go.
How far back does the history of robots go?
It goes back a long way. They say that the ancient Egyptians built moving statues. They were the ones who invented the steam engine.
So they were the original steampunks.
Yeah, right. Actually, there are countless stories in Eastern and Western culture. The Greeks imagined a statue that comes to life. There's the Golem of Prague. You remember Frankenstein. Leading up to C-3PO, an Astro Boy.
But where are the real robots, like, in our world today?
Well, they're mostly in factories. Actually, now there are over a million industrial robots working on assembly lines, doing things like welding and painting.
So those robots are way too busy to be plotting to take over the world.
And I have made that dream come true. There you have the greatest creation of man's intelligence. A human robot!
But one thing we do have to worry about is robot drones. It turns out that robots are better at flying than driving.
Why?
Because there's a lot more empty space in the air than on the road, so there are more variables. The new drones are agile and essentially invisible, so they can observe and then strike without warning.
Which is really friggin' scary.
Absolutely. But there are also many applications where robots could be helpful. See, back in the 1950s, we all thought robots would replace humans. We wanted to work less and have more leisure time. But today we want jobs, so we're focusing on robots that can enhance how we work rather than replacing us.
So robots that are more like companions than tools.
Right. The emphasis now is on robots that can help us with things like folding laundry, driving our cars, assisting surgeons in the operating rooms to be more precise, even helping people walk. There's all kinds of interesting research being done on robots that cooperate with humans.
Well, what about everyday life? I mean, we could certainly use one in our house. What about the robot that actually can clear our dinner table?
Now that turns out to be a surprisingly hard problem. Now, put yourself in the position of being a robot. Everything is out of focus for you. What you see is jittery, confusing. It's very hard to coordinate your sensors and motors. So you're uncertain about your environment and your actions. Nothing is reliable, not even your own body. So when you reach out to pick something up,
you feel very clumsy.
Right. But there's an exciting new concept called belief space.
That sounds so Californian.
It does. But it's a mathematical framework that allows robots to analyze uncertainty and to learn over time so they can predict which actions are most likely to succeed. But belief space requires a huge amount of number crunching to extract the signal from the noise, which is why we're developing another concept that we call cloud robotics. The idea here is that each robot doesn't have to do all the thinking by itself. Instead, robots connect online, over the internet, to clusters of computers that do the number crunching.
Like what humans are doing, sharing information over the web.
Exactly. Robots are now getting on the internet to share data and software.
So does that mean that soon robots are going to meet on Robot Grindr or Robot Facebook?
Or Inner Facebook? Or maybe they'll start procrastinating by watching themselves on YouTube. But even with the cloud, robots are still very far from being as graceful as humans.
I'm finally getting something that in our whole 17 years together, I don't think I've fully gotten as deeply as right now, which is that all of your art installations, they're really about the gap between what humans can do and what robots can't do.
Yes!
Yay! No, I got you!
Because that gap is profound. It reveals those things about us that are uniquely human.
Like what? What are some of the things that robots can't do?
Where do I start? I mean, they don't have intuition. They don't have emotion. They can't be creative.
They can't fall in love.
They can't fall in love. But that's why robots are endlessly fascinating, because they remind us how vulnerable we are and how amazing we are.
I love that. Ooh. Hello. Is there anything that people do with cell phones that annoys you?
Yeah.
Okay, raise your hand, Yes.
When I'm at like a sleepover or something with my friends and I kind of just want to talk and they're texting the whole time, it's really annoying.